Good morning, Ambassador. How are you?
Good morning, Mr. Castor.
Welcome back. You're here all day on the 17th, late into the night, so thank you for your cooperation with the investigation. Did the President ever tell you personally about any preconditions for anything?
No.
Okay, so the President never told you about any preconditions for the aid to be released?
No.
The President never told you about any preconditions for a White House meeting?
Personally, no.
You said you didn't have your records or your documents from the State Department, but if you did, there wouldn't be any document or record that ties President Trump personally to any of this, correct?
Boy, I don't want to speculate what would be
on your documents or records.
I don't recall anything like
that. Okay. No. Good heavens. Okay. You testified Mr. Giuliani's requests for a quid pro quo for the White House meeting. And you indicated that you believe that was, he was evincing President Trump's interests, correct?
My contact with Mr. Giuliani began, as I said, very late in the process, after August 1st, when I was first introduced to him by a text from Ambassador Volker. Right. So we had already begun those discussions, I believe, with the Ukrainians prior to August 1st, so everything was being funneled through others, including Mr. Volker.
Okay. But you testified that Mr. Giuliani was expressing the desires of the President, correct?
That's our understanding, okay. Yes.
But how did you know that? Who told you?
Well, when the President says, talk to my personal attorney, and then Mr. Giuliani, as his personal attorney, makes certain requests or demands, we assume it's coming from the President. I'm not testifying that I heard the President tell Mr. Giuliani to tell us, so if that's your question.
Right, but at your deposition, you said the question was at the May 23rd meeting when the President said, go talk to Rudy. You responded, he didn't even say go talk. He said, talk to Rudy. You subsequently said it was sort of like, I don't want to talk about this. So it wasn't an order or a direction to go talk with Mr. Giuliani, correct?
Our conclusion and the conclusion of the three of us was that if we did not talk to Rudy, nothing would move forward on Ukraine.
Okay. And then that was May 23rd, and then you never had any personal communications with Giuliani until August, right?
That's correct.
And Volker was handling, Ambassador Volker was he
Volker,
the primary?
Volker, Perry, and others.
Okay. Ambassador Volker, you testified he's a professional diplomat, correct?
Yes, he is.
And you said you had a great relationship with him?
I do, yes.
You said he was a very smart guy?
Yes.
Ambassador Ivanovich said he's a brilliant diplomat, in fact. You agree with that?
He's pretty smart.
You stated that he's one of those people I'd hand my wallet to?
I would.
And so, did you hear his testimony yesterday?
I did not.
Okay, because
I was busy getting ready for you.
He didn't have any evidence of any of these preconditions. And he was the one most engaged with the Ukrainians, wasn't he?
Yes.
Okay. I mean, you testified and, you know, this was his full-time job, although he was doing it for free.
He was the special envoy.
And you testified you came in and out of the events, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. At your deposition, we asked you about your communications with the President, and we asked you whether there were so many that it would be impossible to chronicle. And you said, no, it wasn't that many. And we went down the path of building a list of communications you remember with the President, right?
Correct.
We talked about May 23rd in the Oval Office.
Yes.
You mentioned on July 25th, before you went to Ukraine, you called the President, but there was no material information on the 25th call, correct?
Not that I recall.
Okay. Then the last Friday, Mr. Holmes came in, and I guess his testimony refreshed your recollection?
Yeah, what refreshed my recollection was when he mentioned ASAP Rocky, then all of a sudden okay. It came back to me. Yeah.
And talking about the Mr. President Zelensky loving President and so forth?
Well, the whole thing sort of came back to me after mentioned ASAP Rocky.
And then the next time, you know, we tried to unpack this, the next time you talked with the President was on the telephone, was September 9th, according to your deposition, right?
I may have even spoken to him on September 6th, but again, okay. I just don't have all the records. I wish I could get them. Then I could answer your questions very easily.
Okay. But on September 9th, at least at your deposition, you were extremely clear. You called the president. You said he was feeling cranky that day, right?
He seemed very cranky to me.
And you said, in no uncertain terms, and this is on the heels of the Bill Taylor text, right?
Right.
And why don't you tell us, what did the president say to you on September 9th that you remember?
Well, words to the effect, I decided to ask the president the question in an open-ended fashion because there were so many different scenarios floating around as to what was going on with Ukraine. So rather than ask the president 9 different questions, is it this, is it this, is it that, I just said, what do you want from Ukraine? I may have even used a 4-letter word. And he said, I want nothing. I want no quid pro quo. I just want Zelensky to do the right thing, to do what he ran on, or words to that effect. And that gave me the impetus to respond to Ambassador Taylor with the text that I sent. As I said to Mr. Goldman, it was not an artfully written text. I should have been more specific, put it in quotes, something like that. But basically, I wanted Ambassador Taylor, to pick up the ball and take it from there. I had gone as far as I could go.
And you believe the president, correct?
You know what? I'm not going to characterize whether I believed or didn't believe. I was just trying to convey what he said on the phone.
Okay, and at that point in time, the pause in the aid was paused for 55 days. There was a news article in Politico on August 28th talking about it. So by that point in time, the president had been receiving calls from senators. He had been getting pressure to lift the aid, correct?
That's what I understand, yes.
I want to turn back to your opener on page 5. When you talk about, in the absence of any credible explanation for the suspension of aid, I later came to believe that the resumption of security aid would not occur until there was a public statement from Ukraine committing to the investigations, correct?
Correct.
And you acknowledge that this is speculation, right?
It was a presumption.
Okay. That it was a guess. In fact, I think you even said this morning.
Well, I want to say that it goes back to Mr. Goldman's point or Chairman Schiff's 2 + 2 = 4 in my mind at that point.
Okay, but you didn't have any evidence of that, correct?
Other than the aid wasn't being released and we weren't getting anywhere with the Ukrainians.
Okay, but did Ambassador Volker clue you in that was the issue? I mean, this is a pretty high, this is a pretty serious conclusion you've reached without precise evidence.
Well, I sent that email to Secretary Pompeo to set up a potential meeting between President Trump and President Zelensky in Warsaw. And when I referred to the logjam, I referred to the logjam in a very inclusive way. Everything was jammed up at that point. And Secretary Pompeo essentially gave me the green light to brief President Zelensky about making those announcements.
Okay, we can turn to that. And then that was your email dated what date?
Do you have the page there?
Well, your email to Secretary Pompeo.
Was that
August 11th?
August 22nd.
Okay, so you're asking Secretary Pompeo whether we should block time and work. I mean, is there any discussion of specific investigations? Is there any discussion of Biden or Burisma or anything linking to aid in this email that you sent to Pompeo?
This was a proposed briefing that I was going to give President Zelensky. And I was going to call President Zelensky and ask him to say what is in this email, and I was asking essentially President Pompeo's permission to do that,
right,
which he said yes.
But at that point in time, we're talking about investigations into the origins of the 2016 election. We're not talking about anything to do with Joe Biden.
Joe Biden did not come up.
Okay. Stepping back a page to your email to the State Department on August 11th, you email Secretary Pompeo and you say, Kurt and I negotiated a statement from Zelensky to be delivered for our review in a day or two. And the question I have here is that, I mean, that statement never was issued. And in fact, Ambassador Volker has testified that he didn't think it was a good idea, and ultimately the Ukrainians didn't think it was a good idea. And so the statement never reached a finalized state.
That's correct.
But even if it had, it doesn't talk about Biden's or Burisma or anything insidious, correct?
Well, the statement, as I recall, would have mentioned the 2016 election/DNC server and Burisma.
Okay.
It would not have mentioned the Bidens.
And have you heard Ambassador Volker, how he talks about what might be an investigation into Burisma?
No.
Okay. I mean, he has said that if there were Ukrainians engaged in violations of Ukrainian law, then the prosecutor general with the new administration ought to investigate that. Did Ambassador Volker ever relate that to you?
No, we just talked in generic terms about, quote, investigating Burisma.
Okay. But it had nothing to do with Vice President Biden.
I'd never heard Vice President Biden come up until very late in the game.
When?
I don't recall the exact date, but when it all sort of came together, maybe after the transcript of the July 25th call. I don't know. I don't know the exact date when I made the connection.
Okay.
Apparently, a lot of people did not make the connection.
Okay. I want to turn to the letter from Senator Johnson. When he heard about some of these issues in the hold of the aid, he called the president. He called the president on August 31st. It's page 6 of his letter. Senator Johnson states, or he writes, I asked him, the president, whether there was some kind of arrangement where Ukraine would take some action and the hold would be lifted. Without hesitation, President Trump immediately denied such an arrangement existed. Senator Johnson quotes the president saying, no, and he prefaced it with a different word. No way, I would never do that. Who told you that? Senator Johnson says, I have accurately characterized the president's reaction as adamant, vehement, and angry. Senator Johnson's telephone call with the president wasn't a public event. It was capturing a genuine, moment with the president. And he had, at this point in time, on August 31st, he was adamant, vehement, and angry that there was no connections to aid. There were no preconditions.
Yeah, I had my meeting with Senator Johnson where, again, I had made the presumption that I had made to both Mr. Yermak and the email I had sent to Secretary Pompeo. And we were sort of ruminating about what was going on. And Senator Johnson, I believe, said, I'm going to call President Trump, and find out. And then he obviously had that phone call. I wasn't involved in that phone call.
Okay. But you have no reason to disbelieve that wasn't the way it went down, right?
No reason to disbelieve, okay. Senator Johnson.
And now that you've had some time since your deposition and you submitted an addendum relating to the Warsaw get together with Mr. Yermak, as you sit here today, I mean, are we missing a lot of your communications with the president?
I haven't had that many communications with the president, and in fact, a bunch of the call records that I have had access to, just the short period of time on the call indicates I never got through. In other words, I was put on hold for 1 or 2 minutes and the call never connected. So I really can't give you an accurate count of how many conversations. Plus, Mr. Castor, I've had a lot of conversations with the president about completely unrelated matters that have nothing to do with Ukraine.
Okay. But you don't think we're missing any material conversations that you have with the president?
I don't recall any material conversations today as I'm sitting here.
Or with Rudy Giuliani?
Yeah, my memory about the conversations with Rudy Giuliani, whether they were direct, whether they were conference calls with Ambassador Volker or Secretary Perry, is really vague without seeing the call logs.
Are there any other key fact witnesses that would help us, get to the get to the bottom of whether there was any link to the aid and the...
Maybe Brian McCormack, the chief of staff for Secretary Perry, who was involved in and out as well.
Okay. Now, the aid was ultimately lifted on September 11th, correct?
I believe that's correct.
Okay. And Senator Johnson, in his letter on page 6, quotes the president, on August 31st, Ron, I understand your position. We're reviewing it now, and you'll probably like my final decision. So even on August 31st, and this is before any congressional investigation started, the president was signaling to Senator Johnson that he was going to lift the aid.
Sounds like it, yeah.
Okay. And most of the other witnesses we talked to, whether it's from the Department of Defense or OMB or, have told us that all along during this 55-day period, they genuinely believed the hold would be lifted. Was that your feeling, too, at the time?
I didn't know, because every time I asked about the hold, I was never given a straight answer as to why it had been put in place to begin with.
Now, what do you know about the Ukrainians' knowledge of the hold?
Oh, that's very vague. I don't know if the Politico article triggered it. I don't know if they were told by Mr. Giuliani. It would be pure, guesswork on my part, speculation. I don't know.
Okay. I mean, during your deposition, you testified that you did not believe the Ukrainians believe the were aware of the hold until the Politico article.
Yeah. I think I testified that I was not clear on the exact dates of when the light went on. There were a lot of conversations going on with the Ukrainians by a lot of people, so I don't know who communicated what to them.
We have testimony from several witnesses that the president was concerned about foreign aid generally, and so he had an appetite to put holds on aid because he was trying to be a good steward of U.S. taxpayer dollars. Do you agree with that?
I'm aware that that's been his position on aid and other matters, yes.
And are you aware that he was also interested in better understanding the contributions of our European allies?
That I'm definitely aware of.
And there was some back and forth between the State Department officials trying to better understand that information for the president?
Yes, that's correct.
And how do you know that wasn't the reason for the hold?
I don't.
But yet you speculate that there was, a link to this announcement.
I presumed it, yes.
Okay. I want to turn quickly to the July 10th meeting. The July 10th meeting in Ambassador Bolton's office involving Ambassador Volker, Mr. Daniluk, Mr. Yarmak, has been the subject of some controversy. Ambassador Volker yesterday testified that it wasn't until the end of the meeting. Mr. Daniluk, he said, was going through some real detailed information about some of the plans he had. But it wasn't until the end of the meeting, Ambassador Volker recollects, that you mentioned something general about investigations. What do you remember from that meeting?
Well, again, I'm not going to dispute Ambassador Volker's recollection, particularly if he had notes. I know that the desire to have the 2016 election DNC server in Burisma were already being discussed by then. Again, I had no direct contact with Mr. Giuliani on July 10th, but through Ambassador Volker. And I probably mentioned that this needs to happen in order to move the process forward. That seemed to be the conventional wisdom at the time. I don't recall any abrupt ending of the meeting or people storming out or anything like that. That would have been very memorable if someone had stormed out of a meeting based on something I said.
Okay, and nobody accused you at that point in time of being involved with some sort of drug deal?
No.
Did Dr. Hill ever relate to you her concerns about you being involved in a drug deal?
Never.
Okay. So you were surprised when testimony emerged that she thought there was a drug deal going on?
I was shocked.
Okay. And in fact, after the meeting, you went out and you took a picture, right?
Yeah, we, Ambassador Bolton, or his assistant indicated that he was out of time, that he needed, he had another meeting to attend, and we all walked out of the White House. Everyone was smiling, everyone was happy, and we took a picture on the lawn on a nice sunny day.
Okay. Then did you retire to the wardroom?
I think Secretary Perry asked to use the wardroom to continue the conversation, and the real subject that was under debate, and it wasn't a angry debate, it was a debate, is should the call from President Trump to President Zelensky be made prior to the parliamentary elections in Ukraine or after the parliamentary elections? And there was good reason for both. We felt, Ambassador Perry, Ambassador Volker, and I thought it would help President Zelensky to have President Trump speak to him prior to the parliamentary elections, because it would give President Zelensky more credibility, and ultimately he would do better with his people in the parliamentary elections. Others, I believe, pushed back and said, no, it's not appropriate to do it before, it should be done after, and ultimately it was done after.
Okay. There was no mention of Vice President Biden in the wardroom?
Not that I remember, no.
Or any specific investigation?
Just the generic investigations.
Okay. Yeah. When again did the Vice President Biden nexus come to your attention?
Very late. Again, I can't recall the exact date the light bulb went on. It could have been as late as once the transcript was out, but it was always Burisma to me, and I didn't know about the connection between Burisma and Biden.
And to the best of your knowledge, you never understood that anyone was asking Ukrainians to investigate U.S. persons, correct?
Ukrainians to investigate U.S. persons?
Right.
No.
Okay.
No.
And just to sort of be clear here, ultimately the aid was lifted on September 11th. There was never any announcement by the Ukrainians about any investigations they were going to do, correct?
Correct.
The Ukrainians never, to your knowledge, started any of these investigations, correct?
Not to my knowledge.
Consequently, these allegations that there was a quid pro quo that had to be enforced before the aid was released, and it never came to fruition, right?
I don't believe so.
Okay. I want to just step back a little bit and just verify with you that the president had some genuinely deep-rooted concerns about corruption in Ukraine, correct?
That's what he expressed to us, yes.
Okay, and you believed him, right, given his business dealings in the region?
When we had the conversation, I did.
Okay. And when you first started discussing the concerns the president had with corruption, Burisma wasn't the only company that was mentioned, right?
It was a generic, as I think I testified to Chairman Schiff, it was a generic corruption, oligarchs, just bad stuff going on in Ukraine.
But other companies came up, didn't they?
I don't know if they were mentioned specifically. It might have been Naftogaz, because we were working on another issue with Naftogaz, so that might have been one of them.
At one point in your deposition, I believe you said, yeah, Naftogaz comes up at every conversation. Is that fair?
Probably.
You had, I guess Dr. Hill at one point attributed to you the terminology that the president has given you a large remit. Are you familiar with her assertion of that?
I didn't understand what she was talking about.
Okay. But you have, and we got into this a little bit in your deposition, you know, you said that the president gave you a special assignment with regard to Ukraine, correct?
Well, when the president appointed me to the as the U.S. ambassador to the European Union, Ukraine was part of my portfolio. What made my assignment larger than just being part of my portfolio were the unique circumstances where there was no current sitting ambassador in Ukraine, and there was a new president in Ukraine. And the discussions that we had, the three amigos, Perry, Volker, and I, was that Ukraine needed extraordinary, as high a level support as it could get from the United States during this period, which we cleared with both Ambassador Bolton and with Chief of Staff Mulvaney to continue working on it. So by extension, yes, if the National Security Advisor and the Chief of Staff approve your remit, it really is coming from the President.
Okay. When we asked you that at the deposition, you said I was spinning a little bit.
I was spinning about something else, I think, in the interview in Kyiv.
Okay. And you further testified, so when I said the President gave me an assignment, it wasn't really the President, it was the Secretary through the President. And that's where I received my direction, correct?
Correct.
Okay. Did Ambassador Taylor ever bring any concerns to your attention about the so-called the channel he dubbed the irregular?
No, in fact, the opposite. When he came to post, I know I called him, or he called me. I think he spoke with Secretary Perry and Ambassador Volker separately. And in the course of the first few weeks, he was highly appreciative that a new ambassador coming to post like himself was getting the kind of support he was getting from all three of us, having a cabinet member, a special envoy, and a fellow ambassador all helping to raise the profile of Ukraine. He was highly appreciative and highly complimentary.
And you maintained an open line with him, correct?
Correct. I think there are a number of texts, some of which I have and some of which I don't, where he is reaching out constantly to me and to the others for advice and help.
Okay. We had, tried to count them up. There's 215 or something text messages between you, Volker, and Ambassador Taylor. During the early August time frame. Does that make sense to you?
I think Taylor started in late June or early July was when he first took post, and I think we began communicating fairly shortly thereafter.
Okay, and he never communicated any concerns to you during this time frame that he had issues with what was going on?
What do you mean by what was going on?
This request for some sort of investigation.
Not in the early stages. As time went on, his emails began to be a little more pointed and frantic, and that's when we had very little visibility as to what was going on either. I think it had to do more with the aid and as to why the aid was suspended.
Right. And ultimately, you put a period on that issue by having the September 9th communication with the President, correct?
That's correct.
And when you shared that feedback with Ambassador Taylor, was he satisfied that this issue is now behind him?
I don't really know, because he responded when I said, get a hold of the Secretary. He said, I agree, and I never knew whether he reached out to the Secretary or not.
Okay.
That was sort of the end of that.
At one point in your text, you said, let's get on the phone, right? And you said you're an individual that doesn't like to walk through these issues on text when you can talk about it on the telephone, correct?
I say that to everybody when something becomes more substantive than just a few lines of text. I say, let's talk.
Okay. And did you talk with Ambassador Taylor?
I don't recall. Okay. I don't recall whether we spoke right after that, whether he called the Secretary. I basically, Mr. Castor, wanted to get the notion across that I've gone as far as I can go with this. You need to pick up the ball. You're the ambassador. You need to pick up the ball and run with it at this point.
Okay. Just getting back to the irregular channel, did anyone else express any concerns to you about this so-called irregular channel?
I'm not sure how someone could characterize something as an irregular channel when you're talking to the President of the United States, the Secretary of State, the National Security Advisor, the Chief of Staff of the White House, the Secretary of Energy. I don't know how that's irregular. If a bunch of folks that are not in that channel are aggrieved for some reason for not being included, I don't know how they can consider us to be the irregular channel and they to be the regular channel when it's the leadership that makes the decisions.
And so the concerns, raised were never brought to were never brought to a head?
Well, they were never raised.
Okay.
They were never raised. No one said, back off of Ukraine, this is dangerous, you're doing something that's untoward, we have concerns, there was a bad phone call on July 25th, there's talk about a drug cocktail or something. No one ever said that to me by phone, by text, by email. I don't remember anybody sounding any alarm bell, because of course, had someone mentioned it, I would have sat up and taken notice. Everyone's hair was on fire, but no one decided to talk to us.
When you talk in your statement about in the absence of any credible explanation for the suspension of aid, I later came to believe, it was your speculation, it was your guess, that the resumption of security aid would not occur until there was a public statement from Ukraine committing to the investigations of 2016. And I believe you said that at this point, you believed everyone knew this. Is that correct?
I think once that Politico article broke, it started making the rounds that, you know, if you can't get a White House meeting without the statement, what makes you think you're going to get a, you know, $400 million check? Again, that was my presumption.
Okay. But you had no evidence to prove that, correct?
That's correct.
You know, you stated that you haven't been able to access your records. Is that correct?
Not all of them. And there are lots of notes, records, readouts of calls. Can't get to them.
But you've also stated that you don't take notes, right?
I don't take notes, but there are a lot of others out there.
And you freely admit that You know, when last year, I asked at your deposition, we put together a list of all the times you said you don't recall. It's like 2 pages long. So
is that all?
So, you know, you don't, on a lot of these questions, I mean, there's nuance, there are ambiguities, and we don't have records, we don't have notes, and we don't have recollections, correct?
Right. I mean, it's situational things that sort of trigger memory, especially when I'm dealing with the European Union, I'm dealing with the 28 member countries. I'm dealing with other countries that are not in the European Union that are part of my mandate. I'm dealing with the White House leadership. There's a lot of stuff to juggle. And as I said in my opening statement, a phone call for me with the President of the United States or the President of fill-in-the-blank country, while people who get a call like that maybe once in a lifetime, a call like that might be very memorable. They might remember every single thing about it. I'm doing that all day long, and I'm not saying it in a way of being braggadocio or anything like that, but it's part of my routine day. So all of these calls, these meetings with very important people tend to sort of blend together until I have someone that can show me what we discussed, what the subject was, then all of a sudden it comes back.
I mean, we're trying to get to the facts here. We're trying to find out what actually happened, what's reliable, what's accurate. Bill Taylor kept notes. He brought a little notebook in his pocket at his deposition, and he held it up, and he says, when I'm not at my desk and I'm on the phone, I use this notebook. When I'm at my desk, I use a notebook. George Kent said he wrote just innumerable memos to the file. Catherine Croft, she testified that she didn't believe George Kent's notes would be accurate. And so, you know, we have all this, you know, back and forth, but, you know, as we get to the end here, you don't have records, you don't have your notes, because you didn't take notes, you don't have a lot of recollections. I mean, this is the trifecta of unreliability. Isn't that true?
Well, what I'm trying to do today is to use the limited information I have to be as forthcoming as possible with you and the rest of the committee. And as these recollections have been refreshed by subsequent testimony, by some texts and emails that I've now had access to, I think I've filled in a lot of blanks.
But a lot of it's speculation. A lot of it is your guess, and we're talking about, you know, an impeachment of the President of the United States. So the evidence here ought to be pretty darn good.
I've been very clear as to when I was presuming, and I was presuming on the aid. On the other things, Mr. Castor, I did have some texts that I read from. So when it comes to those, I'll rely on those texts because I don't have any reason to believe that those texts were, you know, falsely sent or that there's some subterfuge there. They are what they are. They say what they say.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.